support versus hash a duality. I work for VMware, and I work on Postgres. I'm known probably mostly as the person that
was the primary author of Upsort, but I'm also well known as someone that works on sorting, which somewhat inspired this talk. So I should also mention at this point, you actually can't see it here because it's been cut off, but you can barely see it. So the intention here is that you go, if you are so inclined at least, to this URL, download the slides, because there are citations and stuff like that that you may want to have a look at in your own time. Now, that doesn't seem at all visible, and it won't become more visible at any point, so I guess that didn't really work out. But I can give you that if you want. You can ask me for that. The intent is that you could, if you were so inclined, look at that. Okay. So, first of all, I'm going to talk about nested loop join, which is the most elementary of join algorithms. I'm going to sort of discuss how it's important, why it's important. So here we see an image of a B-tree index. This is actually a fairly small index, but it appears here twice. This is the full extent of the B-tree, whereas this is zooming in on the root here. So there's only one root page, and there's, I believe, approximately 20 leaf pages. So it's a fairly small index. You can see an enormous fan out here. If we were to, that's what we're actually focusing in on there at the bottom, that's to scale. If we were to display the entire B-tree, we would need an additional, I believe, 10 projectors. So you can, if you think of it intuitively, it would be certainly wider than this entire room at that scale. So extremely, extremely wide, a lot of fan out. I sort of tend to emphasize that because I think it's something that's often lost. A B-tree is certainly not like a binary search tree. It's characterized by this enormous fan out, and that's important for reasons we'll discuss in the context of this join algorithm in particular. So I think that's actually 240 kilobytes in size, or 30 blocks, including one meta page. So nested loop join itself, I called it the kind of universal join algorithm, usable in principle to implement any join that can be expressed from SQL. It is literally a nested loop, a for loop within a for loop, with on the inner side typically an index scan, such as a B-tree index scan, typically a B-tree index scan. The output from the inner side is sort of plugged in to the outer side. This is your OLTP queries. Most of your queries really are probably going to be pretty nest loop heavy. So it tends to be that OLTP sees an awful lot of this sort of query and less of the other two. That is sort merge join and hash join, which are the sort of primary topic under discussion here today. Now I'm going to illustrate how in practice a nested loop join works under the hood. So here we're joining sales against coupons. Here's our join output. So on the left hand, the sales table in this example is sort of the outer side. So it's the first for loop, if you will, whereas this one is the second one, whose first value is at this point in time still indeterminate. So we're going to go to the B-tree, scan a value, we obtain what that value is, and that's fed in. So it's plugged in, effectively. Let's do the next one. It's repeated. Again, we start from the root. It's a totally different part of the B-tree in this case, which is not at all untypical. Again, we can attain a value. That value is once again plugged in, and so on. So if we're doing this at all, it's very effective if we only have a fairly small number of things that we're ultimately inputting, because those index grants are possibly completely random in nature. It's very effective if we've got a relatively small amount of data to process in all told. So here's an actual visible explain output. In fact, this example is lifted from the documentation directly. So you could potentially do this at home if you were so inclined. So we're joining this one table against this other table. We've got a predicate here. We also see various costs displayed in terms of the generic cost units that things are costed in terms of. So we can actually do a little bit of math here and determine how the costs are, how those costs sort of percolate up, and how, in general, nested loop joins, their cost is a function of how many rows you're processing quite directly, with a tiny little bit of additional overhead, which is why the total summation here is not quite the same. But it's essentially the cost of executing this, and then for each input, plugging in this, and then getting, so the costs are multiplicative in that sense. So I'm already said, low latency OLTP queries. This is the whole reason, or pretty much the major reason why it's possible in general for us to have really well-performing OLTP queries. You've got like 7 joins, and it takes less than 10 milliseconds. This is the main reason why. Nothing will scale as well as this. You've got a logarithmic lookup for index scans in terms of the number of page accesses in general, and you're never going to, nothing will ever scale as well as this will. This is, in some sense, special because it will be the thing that will continue to scale extremely well as you get more and more data and as less and less of it can be stored in shared buffers. So sort, merge, join, hash, join are not in competition, if you will, with this particular join algorithm. They're more in competition with each other. It makes sense to compare them to each other, but this is a sort of stepping off point for even discussing that. So this is a quote from a guy called Gutz Grefa, a database researcher that I'm known to follow quite closely. And he essentially formally says what I just said. Kind of a bold claim he makes here, effectively independent. That's not quite true, of course, because there's a logarithmic growth factor in terms of the number of levels you'll have to descend. But it is practically the case that the overall size of the B tree, once it passes a fairly small point, will effectively never add another level. Or, theoretically, of course, it will, but the next point that another level is added is so far off as to be not worth considering, so far off that you could never possibly have a table that big in Postgres. It would come against fundamental limits that the system has in that general area. This is only for point scans, though, as I said, when you're accessing relatively few things. Anyway, he continues that the real sort of trick with OLTP certainly is to have things characterized by looking stuff up as opposed to characterized by computing. So you don't want to be searching through and computing against a whole bunch of data. I think that's something that probably many of you have an intuition for already. In general, the main cost tends to be just accessing data itself. And if we can, by using nested loop joins and by having good query plans from a good optimizer, it's often possible for us to have things such that we're mostly just doing lookups, and it's very, very fast and will tend to continue to be very, very fast even as data grows by quite a large amount. Okay. That's all I have to say on nested loop join today. So I'm going to be taking questions throughout. I feel that's a better format for this kind of presentation. So I can take questions on nested loop join at this point if anyone cares to ask them. Okay? No? All right, I'll continue to the main topic under discussion. That is the duality itself. What is a duality? So in mathematics, it's a general term that refers to a relationship between two things that is somehow symmetric. This is perhaps best illustrated by this image you see here, where on the left we have a cube frame with an octahedron dual inside of it. So the frame itself is, this is the cube, this is octahedron. Whereas here we have, you know, we have got an octahedron frame with a cube inside. Now you get from the cube to the octahedron by way of drawing a in the middle of every polygon or plane, you draw a dot and you join them. But in fact, you actually do exactly the same thing over here to get back to where you started. So as with this kind of illustrative example, trying to convey that high-level message that you can sort of understand understand hash join and merge join in terms of each other almost. In fact, you could say that to some degree, hash join was a response to merge join, which was in general available earlier. I'm not really talking about history of Postgres so much as the history of relational databases in general right now. I'll tend to, without acknowledging it, jump from one to the other. So I'm taking a small amount of artistic license in this area. Anyway, so that's the big picture here. Perhaps that seems a little abstract at this point. Hopefully it'll make more sense towards the end. Okay, let's start with an explanation of hash join. Hash join, first we build a hash table on what is almost certainly the smaller of the two relations, input tables. The hash table consists of the join attribute and a hash key for each row alongside the row itself. So we also, having built the hash table, we must then scan the larger table and we perform probes of the hash table, lookups of this ad hoc hash table, which was created just for the purposes of this one query. And as we, it might be that there's no, in fact, it often will be perhaps that there's no thing found in the hash table because the, you know, if it's an inner join, there just wasn't anything found on that particular value that you're joining, that particular pair of attributes, so you continue. And then sometimes, of course, you will find things to join, and then you'll output. We'll see that again in a minute. This only supports equi-joins for the simple reason that, well, that's how hashing works. You know, you can only use it for equality. So this works particularly well when one input is smaller, such as a lookup table. Now I've already said that it's not necessarily the case that you're joining on. So you're joining together two relations, two tables. But in fact, with hash join, it's probably more realistic to imagine joining table A, which has the tuples fed in the first place, using say a bitmap index scan or bitmap heap scan, which is sort of like halfway between an index scan and a sequential scan, you might say. So it's actually a little bit of A and a little bit of B. The output of each A might be a lot larger than B. And so the join could be very poorly, it could be that there's a very selective condition, join condition, and thus most of the hash probes would determine that you shouldn't join for that tuple. And this is actually one case where hash join tends to do very well, because there's no reason why the subset that you're initially, you know, taking up from table A and should be at all correlated with table B. In general, there's no reason to think that, and often there isn't, depending on the exact details of the query. There's also this capability it has around spilling in the event of having not sufficient work to continue without. So you can spill to disk, you can use temp files because of a lack of available working memory. Obviously, you prefer not to do that because that'll be slower. But it can happen. You'll see that in explain, analyze, output. So I'm going to go on to an example of this. Again, this is from the same explain introductory chapter of the Postgres docs. So once again, you could easily do this yourself if you were so inclined. So this is actually very similar to the nested loop join example. The difference only being that before we saw unique one was less than 10, and now it's less than 100. So it happens to be that it's less selective. So we're doing the expensive thing up front and building a hash table on the smaller side and then reusing it. So we cannot start returning stuff until we're done here. So the I misspoke. Okay, there's a little bit of math here as possible as well, and this illustrates how hash join is in some way similar to nested loop join, except the index, if you will, you're using is one that you've created on an ad hoc basis by building your own hash table there and then, as opposed to a pre-existing index, B-tree index that you've explicitly created. It's like you're creating your own index for that one query that one time, which is actually quite a lot different, but there is that similarity. So we can see here there's some additional math showing some additional simple extrapolation of what the cost would have been had instead the optimizer determined that we ought to have used a nested loop join. It would have been more expensive. Actually, that's an only approximate value. It probably would be higher than that, but it certainly... So we can see how the optimizer might have converged on that plan. We can imagine what it might have been like had we forced it to use a nested loop join, perhaps by way of the, we could have, for example, used set enable nested loop join equals off, which would have had the effect of forcing us to use a different plan, which might have been, hash join off. So we could see then perhaps the would-be nested loop plan, which would have been similar to the first one, except it would have been more expensive than this, which is, of course, why the optimizer determined that you shouldn't do that. Okay, I'm going to go on to talk about merge joins now. So merge joins expect sorted input on both sides. So an actual sort node may appear on at least one side of the join, sometimes both. The input is, again, it's possible that if you've got a sort node, it can spill to disk. So it's a little bit like the situation with hash join, except it's not exactly a given that you would use a sort, although it is somewhat common. I'm going to give you a similar example now for merge join. This is obviously a contrived example. If things were really this small, just by virtue of the fact that the startup cost would be significant, this wouldn't actually happen. So this is obviously a toy example for the purposes of illustration. Although the query plans you've seen, those are not toy examples. Those are actually real examples. So, okay, so we start with some input. Okay, there should be a sort step for that. And we're joining against cities. Okay, so they're both sorted. And having done that, which is, of course, the major cost, assuming an actual sort rather than an index scan that's ordered, uses a total ordering of the underlying attributes, the sort would be the major cost if we're imagining that these would use an explicit sort step in both cases, in both sides of the join. So again, we've got a join output we're showing here. And we go through, we sort of have this merge reconciliation process. We've got two pointers at the start of the sort input. The general rule is that we always move the pointer that's pointing to the strictly smaller value. So I'm going to continue. So we're going through, the strictly smaller value goes down. That's not equal, so continue. Now, 3 is equal to 3, of course. So we output a single output tuple, and we proceed. Again, smaller value, and so on. So we actually have skipped some things because the join was not indicated in a couple of the tuples that we went through. Okay. So merge join more flexible than hash join in some ways. So it's not limited to an equi join, and it is. So you can have like range joins and stuff like that, which is so it's not as the things that are the semantics that you could conceivably get a merge join for are not as limited. Okay, another explain from the docs. This is a different table, 1k rather than 10k 2. So there's a similar number of tuples in this join. This is why we see a merge join, because there's the inputs on both sides are similar in the total amount of data being processed. So there's, unlike a hash join we saw before, where there was a clear disparity, it's a fairly similar number, and thus a merge join is indicated as the cheapest plan in the universe of possible plans to the optimizer. We're doing the expensive things up front again. So in that sense, the sorts in this, actually there's one sort here and one index again. The sort itself would be done up front. So we're doing an expensive computation up front, which is bound in size by workmem. So there's a similarity there. Okay. Anyone have any questions on hash join? Yes.
I missed the duality aspects of
this. I'm getting to that. That's like about two thirds of the way through. You're not necessarily expected to sort of grok that yet. Hopefully it becomes clearer. Okay, so I'm going to talk now about the introduction and popularization of hash join. A bit of a history lesson. This image here of a deck alpha from the early 90s. Sort of the first super scale processor. I think it was also the first 64-bit processor. So this image is just intended to illustrate the times and how they were changing around about the early 90s, which is approximately when hash join became popular. Hashing, of course, as a technique for implementing a dictionary abstract data type, for example, has been around basically forever. It wasn't until much later that it became practical to use it to implement joins in relational databases. And in general, this is why. But a quick jumping off point, again, let's go back 20 years to, say, the 70s. Now, memory size is a major consideration. This image you see here is from Donald Knuth's Art of Computer Programming. It's a pull-out section, volume 3, sorting and searching. It shows the scheduling of something called polyphase merge. Actually, only one of them is polyphase merge. There, I think it's the one. It's about the one in the middle, and it's showing you how, when we don't have enough memory to sort, and you certainly wouldn't have in the 70s most of the time if you were doing a merge join. You do sort a small amount of stuff, and then you spill that out, and then you continue and you sort that and so on and so forth until at the end you merge them all together. Now, because you've got so little memory at this point in time, you then end up it's probably infeasible for you to merge them all at once because you only have enough memory. You need to, at a minimum, to have enough memory to store one tuple from every run, which is what these little piles of sorted bits are. Clearly, you'd need at least one from each at a time in order to merge them using a heap or something like that. And certainly, at this time, that would have been a limiting factor much of the time. So this illustrates, in respect of various different algorithms, each represented by a different row, how the scheduling would occur such that I'm going to merge this set of them and then that set of them. And I'm going to merge those together and those together. This is just showing how that would work out in practice for illustrative examples. So stuff is kind of as old as the hills. Memory size, then, a major consideration. So this is actually kind of, it's very old school. Knuth himself sort of admits it insofar as he says, let's pretend we're in the 70s. So I'm not telling you this because I'm romanticizing this era or anything like that. I'm getting to a point. I'm not one of those people that goes to, I mean, nothing against them, goes to a computer history museum or anything like that. So that's not kind of where I'm going with this, if, in case you were worried. It's more like, isn't it interesting and illustrative and even relevant that history is perhaps repeating itself? Okay. So at the time we had a limited number of tape drives. We couldn't have certainly couldn't have as many tape drives as we had runs. I also mentioned we couldn't have as much memory. We couldn't, in general, have enough memory to be assured that we could do everything in one pass. And then the scheduling, the ordering becomes important. We need to use what little memory we have optimally across the various stages of the sort such that things are well balanced throughout. These days, though, it's not like we've, it's certainly still very possible to have to do a external sort. You're never going to have enough memory, or you're never going to care to budget enough memory such that in the very worst case, you'll still get an internal sort. That's actually not a great reason to anyway, especially these days, some of the work I've been doing on sorting, external sorting. You're probably better off using that for shared buffers or whatever. So the reason why we don't have to care about the scheduling stuff at all really these days is because we may not have enough memory, but we certainly have enough memory such that we can be assured that at the end we'll have no more runs than we would. We won't have enough runs that we won't be able to do everything in one pass. We'll certainly be able to easily exceed the amount of memory for our sort that's practically assured. It's not actually assured, it could still happen, but it's not really worth considering cases where you don't have even that much memory. It's just too marginal these days with memory capacity being what it is. In fact, that's been the case for some time. It's not, so this is like the last 20 years, really, or certainly 10. And this is because every time memory capacity doubles, obviously the size of runs doubles with it. But what also doubles is the amount of memory you've got for your merge. So effectively, your capacity for doing things in one pass quadruples. As the capacity doubles. So it's doubled a lot of times since the 70s, and here we are. I should also mention that Grace joins, hybrid hash joins, didn't have any equivalent to this. Their cost function looked quite a lot different. So, you know, we did tend to see there was no plausible alternative for when you had very little memory and you wanted to do hashing. You couldn't really do anything that was good enough. Because you had so little memory relative to your input that it was infeasible. It only makes sense to do some amount of spilling to disk with hash join when it's not that far off from being feasible to do everything in memory. Certainly, you know, not orders of magnitude. Okay, so as I said, hash join introduced because of trends, in particular the trend around main memory scaling, the increase in main memory capacities. And then hybrid hash joins have a plausible and good enough spilling mechanism that the performance penalty, when you don't have, you know, tens or even hundreds of runs, it's not going to happen, we presume, and thus hashing is on a much more competitive footing with merge join. It becomes feasible, it becomes possible. I want to mention here specific optimizations to hash joins. One of the authors is in the audience, actually. That's Thomas Vondra. So this was basically around clever management of memory to avoid cache misses, use of memory chunks. There's also an optimization called Robin Hood hashing in Postgres 10. And then there's a parallel hash join patch Postgres 10. It might get in the next number of days, but I wouldn't count on it. It's just we ran out of time for that one. Okay, so sorting did actually benefit as well. Of course, it was still the case that sorting was necessary. We would still have some inputs that were, you know, more or less equi-sized and very large and so on, and very not selective, so we would have to actually ultimately join most everything against most everything else on the other side. So it's not like merge join is obsolete, and it makes a comeback. This is an illustration from a paper that greatly influenced my work on sorting called Alpha Sort, just showing you, I did work in 9.6 on sorting. I made it so that the quick sort algorithm was used even for external sorts and not just for internal sorts. Prior to that, there was a replacement selection algorithm was used, which uses a heap even for the generation of runs with a view to maximizing the size of runs. On average, it'll manage to make them twice as large as available memory by sort of juggling them. However, this juggling incurs quite a lot of cache misses, and that has a very significant and, at this stage in history, growing penalty. So here, the authors argue, well, this is really cache inefficient, particularly if things are not, you know, the root of the heaps, or you're jumping around all the time, and there's no way this could possibly pay for itself with increasing cache miss penalties. Memory latency becomes a major consideration, starts to become a major consideration around this time. So sort performance has to weigh cache performance to a great degree to address this bottleneck, and it does and has. One of those methods is, as I said, quick sort. There are others. But they're all in that sort of general vein of, let's address memory latency bottleneck. Let's look at where the cache misses are and make them not happen using various techniques. So memory capacity is not the first concern. I already said no one really cares about that, you know, multiple pass polyphase merge stuff anymore. Elegance, not the first consideration. So we're kind of, it's kind of brutalist. We're focusing on really simple code with really tight loops. We're not worried about complicated, elegant algorithms. That isn't where the gains are to be had. This is another image from that same paper, Alpha Sort. This is from 1994. And even here we see, it's kind of a cute picture. I dare say some of you have seen similar things on the web. This is an early example of, let's use an analogy to illustrate the relative costs of memory, main memory access, cache access, et cetera. So I'm just putting it there for illustrative purposes. It's not especially pertinent what those details are. You get the idea. So some stuff on sorting in 9.5, 9.6. Abbreviated keys. This idea that you take the first little bit of a string and you... So when you're sorting in Postgres, you're sorting something like, say, an index tuple or heap tuple or something like that, and you need to follow a pointer. So you're sorting sort tuples, they're called, which is just a fixed size structure that has a pointer to potentially a heap tuple or something like that. So what we're doing here is, instead of necessarily doing that every time if it's a pass by value type such as text, we are instead ahead of time, as we're bringing that stuff into temporary memory, ahead of sort, we're generating at that same time an abbreviated value, say the first few bytes, and that is stored inline alongside the pointer. Now this would have happened anyway if we were sorting integers or something, because those can fit there. But a text datum can be arbitrarily wide, or almost arbitrarily wide, so it generally pays to take the first few bytes and store those there, and then attempt to get away with having most comparisons resolved at that level. And if and only if we can't manage that for comparison, only then do we do the pointer chasing. And that's all we need to do. That was, again, another sort of example of memory latency, memory bandwidth are really what we need to focus on. It's not a very elegant technique, certainly, but it's just what we need to do. Okay. I worked on parallel create next for Postgres 10. That's not going to get in. There might be some more discussion on that, but it's, I think, in the same vein in that there, well, it's in the, it turns out that parallelism and optimizing for the memory hierarchy are very much interrelated problems. We cannot address one without first addressing the other. There's also something called unique joins. I don't want to get into that too much. It's something that's going into the optimizer. It's probably going to get committed to Postgres 10. Concerns realizing that one side of a join can be a merge join, can have a unique path, and thus we can know that once we go up, we don't have to go backup, which is currently necessary. And so we can that realization can result in more efficient plans that were heretofore not possible. That's actually a little bit abstract, but I'm mostly putting it there for reference purposes. By the way, you should ask me at the end if you'd care what that you can't make that a URL out, but you do think to ask me if you want what that is, and I'll read it out for people. Okay, so now I'm entering the more speculative phase of the talk about, you know, my, I guess you could say, prognostications based on readings of papers and things like that. Where am I going with all this? Okay. So this image you see here is from the Stream website. Stream is a benchmark, nothing to do with Postgres in particular, but it's a benchmark for establishing the memory bandwidth of computers. And this little image, which is a log scale, illustrates how this memory bandwidth bottleneck has become extremely acute over the years. CPU speed has increased enormously. DRAM speed has not kept pace. And this basically justifies my total emphasis of cache misses. The difference is so enormous that it couldn't possibly not be the right place to look almost all of the time, certainly as far as sorting goes, and possibly also hashing. Multi-core error problems have their own challenges. Parallelism, of course, is very important these days. We all know this. But then there is, to some degree, as a consequence of that, and to some degree, it's the other way, pursuing parallelism as, you know, the CPU architecture community pursuing parallelism is to some degree, as much as anything else, an attempt to address that bottleneck, which is not intuitive, or it's not something that people tend to talk about as much as the simple idea that you're getting more things to happen at once. So I've already sort of mentioned the context of sorting that I think main memory scaling, the increase in the size of main memory is, as much as anything else, and more probably more than anything else, the kind of transformative technology of the last 30 years. It isn't SSDs or whatever. People tend to talk about that stuff, and it's fine. But I don't think it has the same. Significance as the simple and boring fact that main memory capacities have increased as much as they have. However, this trend seems to have stalled because of power management issues. It seems now that we're not going to reliably continue to get larger and larger memory capacities every year. There are problems with the refresh rate of memory, and so this seems to be a situation that cannot be sustained barring any kind of major innovation, which certainly is possible, but certainly cannot be relied on. So core counts are going up, but we don't see we don't necessarily see, it's a matter of dispute to extent this is true, a sort of concomitant increase in memory bandwidth per core. So if you consider things in terms of serial execution performance, it's possible then that you upgrade your server and you get a slower execution of your query, which is, of course, precisely what you, the opposite outcome to the one that you spent money trying to get. So as much as anything else, parallelism is justified by the memory bandwidth bottleneck. The only way the CPU people were able to increase the amount of aggregate memory bandwidth was through parallelism. So that's really probably more than anything else what's driving it. So the implication for me, say, as a performance-oriented Postgres hacker is this needs to be the first thing almost I'm considering. Even with parallelism, they're very interrelated. It's tricky. I didn't mention, I didn't read it off the slide. The analogy has been made before. It's like driving a Ferrari in New York City. That's apt. Okay. So parallel query, of course, it's a big thing now. There's a talk, I think, tomorrow from Robert Haas about that and where it's going. You might get to go to that as well. So parallel join becomes more important than ever, simply to avoid regressing performance, or at least we can imagine that being possible if it isn't already. That's a plausible thing that could happen, even if it hasn't been directly observed as yet. I'm not aware that it has, but I'm also not aware that it has not been. So I mentioned already, CPU vendors have some ideas, but it's not clear that they'll ever be able to overcome the challenges. I guess we'll find out. So anyway, and you asked me about the duality. I'm sort of getting almost edging back towards that topic. So sort versus merge. Could there be a merge join resurgence? This is a speculation, obviously. So the meta observation that I made, the high level observations I made about the relative merits of sort, merge, join, hash join, may need to be revisited in light of this new bottleneck that's become more and more of a problem. If it was the case before that we had very small or relatively small amount of memory and a lot of disk, which was slow, it might now be that, you know, if cache is the new memory, then the implication perhaps is that memory is the new disk. And thus, it might further be the case that in light of that, you know, some of the relative importance, at least, of sort and merge join might once again, it might once again be that the it becomes more and more important to query performance in general, and that it sort of it's something that perhaps requires re-examination in light of these various trends. Obviously, this is not to say that that there will ever be, you know, I'm not for a minute supposing that we'll ever reach the stage where one will be the winner. That would be absurd because of their fundamental properties. That's ever going to be something that could be disregarded, but the relative shift could actually occur. It's within the realm of possibility. To what degree, I'm unsure. But what I do know is, in principle, if you extrapolate into the future, not that you necessarily ought to, but if you do, it follows then that if you take it to an extreme enough degree, it must be true that if this isn't too abstract, that finally you end up at a place where sort merge join becomes much, much more important. Whether or not that'll happen again, I don't know, but it's a reasonable speculation, and many have speculated just that. There's a link here to a paper discussing that. There's a number of papers. This whole question has been one that the database research community has at various times visited and then revisited. There's also other avenues for improving sort performance that may at one point be evaluated for Postgres. SIMD is something that could plausibly be applied to sorting, but not really to hashing, owing to the fundamental nature of how both of these two things work. How am I for time? Okay. But we have to be quick sort. I mean, you can plausibly have a sort of, you can structure things such that there's an accumulation of work with sorting. You cannot really do that with hashing. And thus, if we extrapolate far into the future, which is perhaps not, you know, I'm not necessarily asserting that that will happen, but logically, we can imagine a time where that becomes the overwhelming absolute consideration, to the extent that the fact is that there are inherently more cache misses required for hash join. Now I'm trying to wrap it up now. Getting back to the duality aspect. So here we see an image similar to the one earlier in the talk. It's just that we have more complicated polyhedra here than we saw the first time around, but the principle is the same. So when I say there's a duality, I think more than anything else, I would sum that up by saying that for sort, there is a physical division and logical combination. Whereas for hash, there's a logical division, but physical combination. This is the fundamental truth of the matter that I keep returning to without it necessarily being obvious. That's the intuition driving all this stuff, if that makes sense. So that's the big picture here. It's less clear, of course, what the practical implications will be. We'll see, I suppose. So that's where I'm going with all of this, and that's the overarching kind of theme, if you will, of my talk. In summary, merge join. Locality, locality, locality. Memory locality, cache misses. It's really important stuff. External sorts degrade slowly and at a predictable rate, whereas hash joins will tend to degrade as memory becomes less and less available, either because the input increases or the amount of memory decreases. It's much faster a rate of decrease. So, you know, going back to what I was saying about the history of those two things, it shows, I mean, you can, if you have a one pass sort in PostgreSQL, typically that will only be, depending on, I mean, there's a lot of variables, but there are certainly cases where that'll only be a little bit slower than doing it all in memory, even though you might only have 1/10 of the memory. In fact, I've even seen cases where, for various obscure reasons, it'll be faster. It's actually not that uncommon. Probably in the latest version of PostgreSQL, you'll see more of it. That is what I actually mean is Postgres 10, which is not out yet. Merge join, it works best with low selectivity join qualifications where it is inherently necessary for us to join most of A against most of B. There's no getting around it. So the overhead per tuple joined is much lower, but there's a huge startup cost. There's, you know, huge cost in general because the join is just inherently expensive. And there's no way around it. Obviously, we'd prefer to avoid it by, for example, reordering the joins within the optimizer. But when that doesn't work out, when we really do have to do a really expensive join with a lot of input on both sides, that's roughly equal. That's when we use merge join. Okay, also with the final on the fly merge step of a sort merge, rather a sort that happens to build a disk in Postgres, we can produce our first output before we've actually finished the sort, because the merge itself, of course, is doing some amount of sorting at the end. So sometimes that'll make the startup cost lesser than even an internal sort, which could, as I've suggested already, lead to us getting a faster overall performance, even though intuitively that shouldn't be the case. It just so happens, what with all these various different considerations, there are in fact cases where, these days at least, it just so happens that the external sort could be faster, and not even, possibly by more than 10%. I've seen cases. It's not that infeasible. Okay, hash join.
1 minute.
Okay, got to wrap it up quickly. Hash join works best with low cardinality attribute join from the smaller table, so you could have a lot of the same value again and again. As I said earlier, you could have a highly selective join qualification, which would be what would work best. So we're mostly joining some random already excluded the other values of table A. So it could be like it could be a bitmap heap scan that you're actually getting both sides of the join from. And it could be that it turns out that most of the hash table probes don't indicate that there should be any value joined, because value not found could happen again and again. Now, you might generally imagine there'd be foreign key relationships, so that couldn't happen. But of course, you've already excluded, before you even built the hash table, perhaps much of the rest of the table. So there's no, because it's a random subset on each side, it could be that it wasn't at all selective when you went to do your hash probes, your hash table. That's where you really do well, and also when one side of the join input is just smaller overall. And it doesn't, it's very sort of random, the memory locations you're accessing. And that is an inherent property of how hashing works, for reasons I think are relatively obvious. And that's all I got. Anyone got any questions? Oh, okay. Well, worked out. Yes, yes.
Would you be able to calculate like a break-even point of number of cores versus memory, maybe by extrapolating into the future when merge join becomes a better performance than hash join?
I personally would not be inclined to, because I'm pretty busy. But someone has. There are theoretical models that support that contention, that you could if you look at the slides, there's make sure to download the PDF and don't use the web thing because it's better. The hyperlinks work only in the PDF. So I'll read that out for anyone that's interested. So it's speakerdeck.com/peterg/sort-hash-pgconf-us-2017. So you can review their thoughts on it. I think it's obviously speculative, but it's, I would say, at least an interesting speculation. So I'm obviously a practitioner that's thinking ahead, but I can only think ahead so far, given my constraints on time and stuff like that. But that's where I see myself going with it, if anywhere at all. That's the only kind of frontier that remains. Okay, thank you. Thanks.